forever and ever. Oh Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. My soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great. God, his son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation, take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration, and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Hey, good morning, everyone. You guys can be seated. Good to see you all this morning at Berean Bible Church. I'd like to welcome you to our morning service. As always, I mean, this is your morning avalanche of activity. Are you ready? Are you ready? Okay, I want you to know, hey, it's a beautiful day out again, beautiful fall out here. I mean, make sure you guys are fired up and ready for a good church service. Got a good message for you, got some good worship here. So I hope you're excited about worshiping the Lord, man. He's a good God and greatly to be praised. So I want to give you just a few events here. And, you know, we're going to start off. Number one, you know, right here, big day today. Big day right here, guys. What does that mean? What does that mean? Nick?
He's open.
Nick, you're open? Yo, look at that, baby. Come on, hit him in the back, man. Here we go. Who wants it? Who wants it? Jake, you ready? Come on, brother. Hey, look at that. There we go, man. We're good right there. Wide receiver, Nick. Sign him up. Wide receiver. Jake, we'll expect you down there. 130.
That's a tight end, man. Look at
All right, today, 1:30. Be down there a little early. We're going to be dividing up the teams. So we're going to be meeting down at the field down by the pool. Okay, so you park in the big parking lot, walk yourselves on over. We also, Nick, have brand new flags for this year.
Brand new?
Yeah, brand new. Brand new flags. Yeah, so we're a high-tech organization now here. So some pretty stuff. There's goalposts down there, too. We might be kicking some field goals. If you want to come down and watch, just hang out, enjoy. I mean, it's going to be a good time. So meet down there today, slightly before 1:30, so we can get the teams lined up and get started promptly at 1:30. Also, tomorrow, we have a great time here tomorrow night. Mission Barbecue Catered Freedom Ministry Banquet. If you like Freedom Ministry Sunday, there's still time to sign up. I padded our numbers a little bit to get some last-minute people under the wire. The sign-ups will be in the back for that. I mean, what's going to be happening here tomorrow night? First of all, we're going to have a banquet at 6 o'clock over in the cafeteria. Mission barbecue, brisket, you know, pulled pork, all the good stuff. Nick, sweet potato mashed potatoes. What do you think of that?
That sounds delicious.
You like that? Okay, I'm just checking. I mean, I took a little risk, rolled the dice on that. So there you go. So, other good stuff as well. Macaroni and cheese, can't go wrong with that. You know, plenty of good stuff there. After that, we're going to come back in here. We're going to have a nice time of worship, some testimonies, as well as you hear how God's transformed people's lives through his grace. And then we're going to hear from a special speaker, Pastor Sean Roach, who's going to be talking about his own testimony, you know, growing up and his experience, you know, with addiction, and also sharing with us from the Word of God. Be a great time to praise the Lord tomorrow. And so we'd love to see you out at that. Again, last time to sign up today, sign up in the back. Our senior singles, have two activities coming up. First thing that we have is, on Wednesday, we have our lunch at Springhouse Tavern. So that's coming up this coming Wednesday. Make sure you sign up, in the back, for that. And the second thing, is we're going to be going out to Sight and Sound to see the Miracle of Christmas, December 20th, along with breakfast at Diener's Restaurant right there. So if you're a senior single, you can sign up in the back for those activities. Also, we need help because Christmas is rapidly approaching. I know that sounds very strange, but it is. November 26th, right after church, we're asking for your help to decorate the church for Christmas. It's a big affair, and we definitely could use your help, with that. And so lunch is going to be provided that day. Just stay right after church. We'll get our decorations in, make the place look nice for Christmas, as it always is, and we appreciate your help for that. Also, New Ladies Bible Study, on the Advent, our hope has come, coming up, please sign up, in the back. You can see that's the start date there, on the screen for you. So we need you to sign up, in the back for that, as well. And also, we have found a big lump of lost keys. Like, looks like, somebody fairly important. This big, big ring of keys looks like, somebody that has a facility manager or something. But if you lost a big lump of keys, please come see, me afterwards. They are in the office. If you did lose your keys here, in the building recently. With that, I'm going to ask Miss Anna Kay if she would come up. She has one special announcement for you as well. Would you welcome her, please? Thank you.
Good morning, church family. I'm here to invite you to my Christmas concert on Saturday, December 2nd at 7 p.m. Berean has been so gracious to allow me to host the concert here, and the doors will open at 6 if you'd like to be early and engage with several vendors who will be here supporting the event. It will be a night of incredible music with a full jazz band and my friend Sarah Brown, who is a singer-songwriter and teacher at Coventry Christian School. We hope to inspire and encourage you as you prepare your hearts for the Christmas season. We will also be spotlighting International Justice Mission, an incredible organization that works with local law enforcement, social services, and churches around the world to rescue and restore men and women and children caught in modern slavery and trafficking. I'm reminded of Matthew 5:16. In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. We face dark times, but God promises that as we shine our light, he will be glorified. We are not to shrink back, but press into the darkness and do everything we can to stand and bring the light of Jesus. Please consider coming and bringing a guest who may not know him. Tickets are $35, and a portion of the sales will go to IJM. Please take a moment to check your schedule and scan the QR code with your phone camera to reserve tickets. I have some posters on the back table and will be there after service to hand them out and answer any questions. I would appreciate you sharing them at your place of business or gathering. I hope to see you there. Thank you.
Thank you, Anna Kay. I said in a sermon a long time ago that the Bible is a symphony, and that justice is one of the major motifs. God is for justice. And when you hear things done to children, well, that hits you in places that you didn't know you had. And it's understandable to be filled with rage because of it. Maybe a righteous anger, righteous indignation. The question is, what do we do with it? And so we act now, but also keep the eternal hope that the eternal judge will one day bring peace on this earth, but also destruction to the wicked who do those things. And that's actually a part of the song that we're going to be singing. I just want to sing for you the end here. I want in this song it says forever without end. It says if you know it and you want to sing along, you can. Forever without end, creation will rejoice when works of wicked men you finally destroy. Your power will proclaim till Christ descends, and you will reign forever without end. Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you that you are a great God and your goodness knows no end. And today we're going to sing your praises, strengthen our voices as we sing the song of justice, that we serve a great God who has given us freedom, freedom through the death of his Son, and eternal life through the sacrifice on the cross, being buried, and raising on the third day. In Jesus' name, amen. Please stand as we sing. I'll bless your name, O God, each day that I awake. From dawn to setting sun, your greatness I'll proclaim. Your glory far exceeds all human thought. So with each breath I'll bless your name, O God. Your name will be revered by children yet to come. As generations sing of wonders you have done, your strong and mighty deeds are always new. Oh God, most high, your name will be revealed. How great is the Lord,
God. How great
Our scripture for this morning is once again Titus 2, 11 through 15. I think you guys probably have this memorized by now. For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation for all people, training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in the present age, waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify for himself a people for his own possession, who were zealous for good works. Declare these things. Exhort, rebuke with all authority. Let no one disregard you. For whatever authority we exhort with, it all comes from the fact that there is indeed a king seated among us. And we are all subject to that one authority, his name, Jesus Christ. There is a king seated among us. Let every heart receive him now. Where there is praise, he will inhabit. There will be grace and mercy all around. And every burden will be lifted in his presence. Every trophy will be laid down at his feet. There is a name that reigns above all others. Jesus Christ, the King above all kings. Unto the Lamb, honor and glory. Worthy is he who overcame, buried in shame, risen in power. He is alive, the stone is rolled away. All our worship will belong to him. Death is conquered, and our Savior holds the keys. There is a name that reigns above all others. Jesus Christ, the King above all kings. Holy, holy. He has given us systems of authority, and among those are the ones that defend our lives. This past week, we recognize veterans all across this land who fought for us. And so if you have served in the military to protect us, I ask you to please remain standing while the rest of us please take a seat as we can honor those who through bravery protected us. Thank you. We thank God for you. We have so many things to thank Him for. So together, we're going to give thanks for the Lord is good. Song we began learning last week.
His love endures.
Father. We thank you that your love does indeed endure forever and ever. We do not need to fear you leaving us on our own. The one whom our soul loves is the one who will never let us go, not on our own merit, but because of your great, great love. And because you love us, we trust you with those you have put over us. May you continue to keep them in your wise counsel on the straight and narrow path. In Jesus' name, amen. You can greet somebody, then take a seat.
Nice catch. I figure I won either way. I mean, if you bobbled it, I would have had a good thing, and if it wasn't, I mean, you look like a champ. It's pretty good, man. All right, our message for this morning is entitled Authority from Titus chapter 2 and verse 15. If you get your Bibles out there, we're again looking at the finish of this second chapter here today. I want you to see the encourage and the admonition and the challenge here to us from this 15th verse, just one verse today. It's a good one. It says, "These then are the things that you should speak. Encourage, rebuke with all authority. Do not let anyone despise you." Now, when I came to this, passage, we do expository preaching here at Berean. We simply take a book of the Bible and we go verse by verse, through that book. We don't skip verses. We don't just gloss over things. We don't just preach on that which is comfortable to us. Or that which is, easy for people to hear, but rather, we want to share with you, as in Acts, Paul says, the whole counsel of God, all of it, not just part of it, but every verse. And that means that sometimes, there are things that we preach on that are even a little bit uncomfortable to hear or even somewhat uncomfortable for people to preach, especially pastors. And this is, one of those passages. But again, we don't skip things here. We try to give you a good balanced diet of the word. And so, we're going to tackle this passage, here this morning. In the area of review, just so we can remember the context of what we've been doing, remember that Titus was sent by Paul to set in order, the churches of Crete. And that's what we've been, using as our theme, the information, the background, of the book. Remember that the Cretan people were not conducting themselves, in a matter that was consistent with, last week's message, with redeemed people or people who had had their heads taken out, of the chains. And so Titus was going to be the heavy. And it was his job to go in and to whip these churches into shape, by exerting, authority. And so this was not going to be an easy process. It wasn't going to be without some heartache, without some hard feelings, probably, without some people getting booted out of the church. This was going to be messy. It was going to be sticky. It was going to be difficult, but it was going to be necessary for the preservation of the gospel message and the testimony of the churches in Crete. Because God desires, above all things, a holy church. And so this was his job. And so Titus was to bring right doctrine to the people, which would then in turn produce right conduct. When you have good teaching coming into your life, its inevitable, result is that it produces health, produces good fruit, and a church that is honoring to Christ. Where there is bad teaching, you're going to end up with bad fruit. And so that's why, we see verses like this, where the authority, of the leadership of the church is stressed, to the people. And so, as we begin, we ask ourselves a question. So Titus was told to do this, to go into these churches and to straighten them out, but what authority, or by what authority was Titus to do these things? And that's a legitimate question. You know, where did Titus' authority come from? Does that same authority exist in the church today? And who wields that authority, and why and how? So that's what we're going to try to investigate, I mean, as we sort of move through our text today. Now, in the area of background, I want to share with you a brief ecclesiology. Now, that's one of those 10 areas of doctrinal study that you study in systematic theology. Ecclesiology is the study, of the leadership structure, the authority structure, of the local assembly. And I have this, for you, in a simple, triangle, graph here. See, my PowerPoint skills are real. I'm really upping my PowerPoint game here lately, and this is one of those. So what you're going to notice here is you're going to notice, the hierarchy, of the church, right? And so what sits at the very top, of the pyramid is God. God is, the ultimate authority over the church, right? Jesus said, in the Gospels, in the Great Commission, all authority in heaven and earth, can you complete the verse, has been what? Given unto me. That the Father had entrusted Jesus with all authority concerning the church. And so, the head of the church, is God, and Jesus Christ, his only Son. Okay? So we all recognize God's authority in our lives, and I don't think we need to spend an undue amount of time just sort of going over that. And then, as Christ is on earth, what is he doing? He's working with the 12 disciples who will eventually, not all of them, will become the 12 apostles. And so after, Jesus, is gone, from the earth, and while he was, there, he entrusted, divine authority to, set the doctrine, of the church, to teach, the gospel message, to make sure that things were being done decently in order, in the churches. He gave that authority, to the apostles. And then, the apostles, their job, was then to go, and we have the next layer down, was to, in the individual churches, was to appoint elders. Now, these elders, were the next layer, of leadership that we see, here, in the first century. And these elders, were then to govern the individual smaller, churches, because obviously there was only, a limited, number of apostles. And so elders were necessary, to be able to take the teaching of the apostles and, give that, bring that to the church, on their authority. And then, alongside to, underneath the elders, to be able to assist the elders, we have the office of deacons. And so a church has deacons, that they serve, at the pleasure of the elders to do the jobs that the elders do not have time to do, because they're ministering in the word, and in leadership, for the local flock or the local congregation. And so we have, God, to the apostles, to the elders, to the deacons, and then finally to the congregation. This is a simple ecclesiology, or the way that the local church is to be structured biblically. That's the way Berean Bible Church, is set up. Now, a couple of observations on this, and we'll go to the next, slide here, is that obviously, there's something, missing here today. There are no apostles anymore, correct? Now, I know there are some people that will claim that they are apostles. And that is very big today. And don't be deceived. There are no more apostles today. And I can prove it to you very simply. We're not going to get into a whole study of this, but I could. One of the qualifications for, the apostles, to be an apostle, was you had to have seen with your own two eyes the risen Christ. Now, I don't believe that there's anybody alive today that has seen the risen Christ. And so when we do not have apostles anymore today, they were a unique and limited group of people that were with Jesus, from his baptism, through his resurrection, and had personally were eyewitnesses of the things that he said, and did. And so with the apostle John, the last of the apostles die out, and so there are no longer, any apostles. So now if we look at our leadership, thing, we have, God, we have the Lord Jesus Christ, and we have the elders, we have the deacons, and we have the congregation, because again, there are no more apostles today. But do we still benefit from the ministry of the apostles? We do. How? Right here. We benefit from their ministry because we have, the word of God given to us. And, many of these books were written, by the apostles or by eyewitnesses, of Jesus Christ. And so there are no apostles, anymore today. And so today, the authority in the church, comes, or falls, upon the elders. They're the ones, that have authority. And notice when you look back, in the book, that Titus, you know, in verse 5, chapter 1, just look there real quickly if you would. The reason why I left you in Crete was that you might straighten out what's left unfinished. And what? And appoint elders in every town as I directed you. That was, you mean, his mission. So, you mean, we can see that elders, you mean, were to be appointed, and a plurality of elders, you mean, were important. Don't just, you know, appoint one elder, you mean, over every church, you mean, in this town, or multiple churches in the town, but appoint multiple elders, you mean, in these churches. Now, the reason why, you mean, elders is plural, you know, here is because a plurality of elders is a protection for any local congregation. No one man leads and carries all authority in the local church. That's given to a plurality of elders so that if one crazy dude goes off the rails, you're protected because a plurality of people are probably not going to do that, okay? So that is why a plurality of elders, that's why elders were to be elected in every town that would oversee, I mean, the things going on, I mean, within the churches, especially the teaching. Now, elders, I mean, were not just picked at random. They weren't like, hey, you know, you're breathing and you have, you know, at least three limbs, so hey, you know, come on over here, buddy, you qualify, right? That's not the way this worked. Remember that earlier, Titus laid down qualifications. We see that, you know, Paul laid down qualifications in 1 Timothy. That there were people that had to qualify for these offices within the local church. They had to qualify to be able to wield this authority because it was a serious responsibility. And so, I mean, it is godly men that is entrusted, I mean, with this that meet the qualifications laid out for them. And one of them that was that they needed to be able to what? To teach. They needed to be able to teach. They needed to be able to share the word of God. That was, you mean, one of these things that we see listed, you mean, for them, you mean, in these pastoral epistles. And so the elders, you mean, were the ones that were supposed to teach and have authority, you mean, in the local church. But there's sort of an issue here. So, you mean, we looked at the church, the chart that I had for you there in my, you know, really cool graphics, but there was one sort of name that's left out of there. Well, why isn't pastor on the chart? Where does the pastor fit into all of this? Now, there's a lot of people that are confused about this, and I don't want you to be confused. I'm going to look at a little cross-reference here from 2 Peter chapter 5, okay? So if you want to, you know, you can, it'll be on the screen for you here, but if you want to take a look at this, I want to show you, you mean, a little bit, you mean, about the church leadership structure here, right here from, you mean, from the words of Peter, I mean, to his, you know, Jewish hearers. He says this, he says in chapter 5, verse 1, "Therefore I urge elders among you, as your fellow elder and witness of the sufferings of Christ." Now, was Peter an apostle? Yes, but he also functioned as an elder. Okay, see that? He says, "And as a witness of the sufferings of Christ, and one who is also a fellow partaker of the glory that is to be revealed." And so to the elders, he says, or he gives them a command, right? He says, "Shepherd the flock of God among you." Now, let's take a look at the words here really quickly. The word for elder, you mean, is the word presbyteros. Implied within the term is the idea of age. That if you're going to serve as an elder, that if you're going to, you know, serve, you mean, you know, in that capacity of leading the church and carrying, you mean, this divine authority, it's probably not a good idea that we elect a 16-year-old to that job, okay? We see this pattern in Judaism. You could not, you mean, even consider, you know, being a rabbi until you were at least how old? 30, right? And so the term elder, you know, refers to someone who has experience, someone who has wisdom, someone who has some age to them, right? So that's the word elder that you see right there in blue. And to these same people, to these same elders, Peter is saying, "Shepherd the flock of God among you." There's where your term pastor is. The term for pastor, you know, right here, you mean, in this passage, you mean, is the word pomein. And what does it mean? Really simply, shepherd. That's what it means, shepherd. So what you're noticing here, you mean, is that these two words are what? They're interchangeable. Because elders are what? Pastors. And pastors are Did I lose you already? Do I need to start over? Maybe I go back to the beginning. No, elders are pastors and pastors are elders. Okay? They're the same office. Okay? That's really important because a lot of people don't get that. A lot of people miss that. Let's continue on. So to the elders, I urge you to be shepherds. Shepherd the flock among you, exercising oversight. Now there you have another word. This is the word here, the word overseer, some translations will have. Some people call their elders overseers. And this is the word episkopos, epi above, like epitaph, you'll see on a tombstone, that kind of thing. And then skopos, you get the microscope even from that, to watch above, to watch over. And so, overseers, elders, pastors, it's all the same office. Okay? So then why do we call Jeff and Jace and maybe Caleb, depending on the day he's having? He's not here, so I can pick on him, right? And Nick, why are we called pastors and the rest of the guys are just called elders? Well, the only thing that sets, us apart, we're the ones that are ministering in a full-time capacity, and we're the ones that are doing the majority, of the teaching and the leading, up front in a visible way. And, whether I'm preaching the Word of God or Nick is up here, in such an excellent way, leading you, in worship, those are important, jobs of leadership. And they're meaningful. And so you'll read about in, say, 1 Timothy, that the elder who teaches, okay, you see that phrase written there, that the elder who teaches, is the guy that we oftentimes, call the pastor. But he holds no more authority, in the church than any other elder. He is one of them. When we go to our board meetings, where our elders, meet, and, we have to make a decision about something, we take a vote. And the pastor has a vote, and the other elders have a vote. But I don't get two votes because I'm a pastor. Nick doesn't get four because he's a music pastor. That's not the way it works. Everybody has, one vote because we are equals in that. The only thing that sets the pastor apart is not, in his authority, but it's in the fact that he's the visible guy up there, the elder who is teaching, okay? Now, a lot of people don't understand that. They don't get that wrong, but that's a very biblical concept that we see, here, in the way that the church is set up. And so, Titus was given, authority by Paul. Now, again, let's go back to our verse. These things speak and exhort and rebuke, and here's the phrase, with all authority. Okay? Now, this verse is very, very, very strong. And the reason why this verse is very, very, very strong is because of the terrible situation that the churches in Crete were in. And I told you before that when Titus came in to straighten this out, he was going to have to throw his weight around. Did he have weight to throw around? You better believe he did. He had divine authority. It was given to him, by the Lord, through the Apostle Paul, then to the elders, then to the congregation. Down our chart. Makes sense to you? Paul was an apostle by the command of Jesus. He says so in 1 Timothy chapter 1. It's the same word, authority. The word in Greek is at the end of the bullet points there on the screen for you. It's the word epitage. And literally it means command or order. That Titus, had the authority to command and to order obedience in the churches of Crete. Paul says that he was appointed to be an apostle by the epitage of God, by the command of Jesus. And so if we follow our train, that Paul was given authority by Jesus, and Titus was given authority by Paul, and Titus was to appoint, thank you both of you, Paul was to appoint elders, and they were the ones that were supposed to take that teaching down the line with that authority and command obedience to the word of God in the churches because the people were a mess, because the teaching was a mess. Make sense? Remember, you become what you worship. So that's what we see. That's why this verse is in here, okay? Now, when we look at the elders, they possessed all authority from the Lord. Now that's sort of a, that's a big deal. And it was a huge responsibility. We're going to comment on that in a minute. But I want you to see, I mean, this word, you mean in a couple other contexts, just to get a full sense of it. It's used two times, you mean, of Jesus, epitage, or similar words that are related to it. Verse 27, you mean, and, okay, I forgot to write down what book this is, but, I mean, it's probably Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John, one of those other ones, but you'll be familiar with it. And they were all amazed, and they debated among themselves, what is this, a new teaching with authority? Interesting, right? What does it mean that Jesus taught with authority? Well, every time the rabbis taught, I mean, in the first century, you know what they did? They made sure that they quoted somebody. Well, you mean the Rabbi Hillel, you mean in 1462 said this. Well, I guess it wouldn't be 1462 back then, but you get the idea, right? I mean, you know, they would quote the different rabbis who, you know, had different views on things, and they would, you know, quote the writers or the authors of Scripture. But when Jesus taught, he just taught as if he wrote it, as if what he said was the final matter. And it was. Why? Because he is literally the Word of God, isn't he? And so they were amazed that he teaches with such authority. He didn't quote anybody. He didn't have to appear, he didn't have to make any legal arguments to anyone about anything. He was the authority. And so he taught with authority, and he commands, interesting, he commands even the spirits who obey him. And then in Luke chapter 8, and this one I did manage to get the reference in there, who then is this, that he commands even the winds and the water, and they obey him. There's again, you mean a similar concept. But Jesus had authority, you mean, over unclean spirits, over demons, and he had authority, you mean, over the wind and the water, the natural world. And that's the same word that is used, and the same concepts are used here, you mean, in similar words, as in Titus. Now, you mean, another thing that Jesus said, you mean, here in John chapter 8 is this, and I find this one really interesting. I have many things to say and to judge regarding you, but he who sent me is true, and the things which I heard from him, these I say to the world. When, you mean, the disciples are talking to Jesus about some of his difficult statements, you mean, where did Jesus, you mean, get his teaching from? What does this say? What does this verse tell you? From the Father, right? So when Jesus is on earth, what's he teaching? He's teaching that which he received from the Father. He's very clear about that. Multiple times he says this in the Gospels. Now, that was, you mean, pretty easy for Jesus. But when you stop and consider, say, you know, us, if Jesus' authority came from the Father, how can we hear from the Father today? Right there. You know, we can hear from the Father too. We know what the Father says. We know what Jesus says because we have the Word of God. And so when we start, you mean, adding this up, elder authority, pastoral authority comes through what? The Word of God. Pastors and elders carry authority when they are speaking and teaching and holding people to the commands of what? Of their own desires. No. When they're calling people to obedience to the Word of God, the words of Jesus, the words of the Father, right? Makes sense? That's our sphere of authority. If we step outside of that sphere, we're no longer carrying divine authority. When you tell someone, when you speak into their life the Word of God, you're also speaking with authority. Not your own, but God's, because the authority is in the Word of God. And that's tremendous. And so over and over and over again, what do you see? You see commands like this, I mean, to a young Timothy, who's, you know, Paul's, you know, who Paul is mentoring and is, you know, who's his protege. He says, I solemnly charge you this, 2 Timothy chapter 4. I solemnly exhort you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is the judge of the living and the dead and everything in between, And by the appearing and by his appearance in his kingdom, what's he told to do? Preach the word. The entire job of the elder pastor is summed up right there. Preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season to correct, rebuke, and exhort with patience and careful instruction. Using what? Using the word of God. And so that's, you mean, what we see, you mean, consistently, you mean, through the scriptures. J.I. Packer, incredible, you know, godly man, wrote a number of great books. He said this, the Bible is the real preacher. The role of the man in the pulpit or counseling chamber is simply to let the passage speak through him. I mean, I could stand up here all day and tell you all kinds of wonderful stories and all kinds of, you know, my opinions, but at the end of the day, what's that worth? Watch it now. Be nice. Not much. But the elder's job, the pastor's job, the teacher's job is to share the word of God because that's where the authority is. That's where the power is. That's where life transformation comes from. Not from the crafty opinions of men, but from the scriptures. They're the ones that are able to make you wise for salvation. They're where faith comes from. Faith comes from hearing and hearing from the word of God, right? Now, to me, this is what gets me up in the morning. Teaching the word of God. I get so excited about it, can you tell? Because to me, this is a tombstone issue. Now, you say, what is a tombstone issue? A tombstone issue is, if you're going to say one thing about you on your tombstone, what? Yo, Nick, seriously, bro? I could have said, Pastor Jeff Scholl, he preached the word. Now I got that up there. Great. Thanks a lot, Nick. I appreciate that. The staff just loves to mess with me around here. A tombstone issue is, it's, you know, if I don't want anything else, if you want to remember me for one thing when I'm dead, I hope it's that would be said about me, that I preached the word of God, that I taught the word of God. Because at the end, nothing else matters. That's the key. That's where we need to focus, right? Because it's the word of God that changes lives. John MacArthur said this, as long as the pastor is faithful to the word, He has the awesome privilege to minister with God-given authority. And he's right. Now that is a terrifying concept if you are an elder or a pastor. And along with that comes a balance. Let's take a look at this verse. I mean, you're right here. For some reason, I omitted putting any of the references where these are actually found. You mean, for whatever reason, I don't know. You mean, I don't know what's going on with me this week. But anyway, I think this is James, right? Am I right about that? I mean, I think it's James. Okay, thank you very much, folks. I needed that. Hold me accountable. James chapter 3, do not become teachers in large numbers, or I would not that many of you become teachers, my brothers, since you know that we who are teachers will incur a stricter judgment. That applies to elders and people who wield, you mean, that, you know, God-given authority. That we have a great responsibility, a great privilege, but we also carry, you mean, a great weight. And that weight is knowing that we're on the hook for that authority and how we use it. That we have to give an account and our judgment will be stricter because we had this great privilege given to us. With privilege comes responsibility. And by the way, any pastor knows this is the most terrifying verse in all the Bible. Because literally, I have taught messages at this point in my life in the tens of thousands, and yes, I counted. That's terrifying beyond imagining. I've taught a lot of things. And I know that I'm an imperfect person who doesn't perfectly live up to everything I say. It's impossible for anybody to do that. I'm a sinful man. I don't want to hear hear, hear, or amen on that, please. Thank you. Sheesh. Again, so, again, the elders, I mean the pastor, they carry all authority, the scripture says. And now we're going to take a look at a couple of these other words in this verse here. He says here, these things, okay, so what are these things? These things refer to the stuff that he just got done saying. In verse 11, you mean through verse 14, or you mean maybe even all the way back, you mean to the entire book, everything prior to 2:15. But certainly I think the immediate context would be the best thing. For the grace of God brings salvation to all men. Teach to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions, to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age, while we wait for the blessed hope, the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, who gave himself for us, who redeemed us from wickedness, to purify for himself a people who are ready to do good works. There's your entire Christian life summed up in a couple verses. These things teach. The word literally is laleo. These things speak. Have these things on your lips continually, over and over again. Share them with the churches. Share them with the congregation. Share them with the people. Be faithful to that message. These things speak. The second thing he says, these things encourage or exhort. Here the word is parakaleo. It's one of my favorite words, I mean, in the New Testament. Para, meaning beside, alongside of. And you mean kaleo, meaning to comfort. Encourage, help. The reason why we are to speak the word of God is to come alongside of people and to help them live the Christian life, to encourage them in their walk with Jesus. That's the purpose of our speaking, to encourage. There are a number of spiritual gifts that are given to the church. The one that operates most strongly within me is the gift of exhortation. The reason why I get up in the morning is to share the word of God with people, to encourage them to see what God is doing, I mean, in his word, and to see how that applies to them, and to see them growing in their relationship with Christ. Man, there's not a single thing that gives me more joy in this earth than that, including winning a disc golf tournament. These things encourage. That's the role of the pastor, to take the word of God and encourage people, to build them up in their faith. That's the positive side. Now, the negative one. These things teach, exhort, and one more, and rebuke. The word rebuke here means correct. And the idea is, correct, and there should be a comma after correction. I swear we edited that. I swear we did, but whatever happened, I have no idea. But anyway, correction. And the idea is exposing with the suggestion of shame of the person being rebuked. That's in the word itself. Oof. That one's a little tough. Here you are, you're a believer. You're part of the local congregation. You're out there sinning it up. You're not being obedient to the word of God. It's causing a shame, you mean, and a disgrace to the testimony of the Lord and of the church. What's the responsibility of an elder, you mean, or a pastor? The responsibility is for us to come and to offer a rebuke, a correction. Encouragement is needed sometimes, and correction is needed sometimes. And all of these words, I mean, in the original language, mean are commands. Keep on speaking, keep on encouraging, and keep on correcting. Because that's what the Word of God is profitable for, right? Now, here comes blow your mind quote of the day. You ready? Those other two were good, but this one's amazing. This is William Barclay. He says this, "The eyes of the sinner must be opened to his sin. The mind of the misguided must be led to realize his mistake. The heart of the heedless must be stabbed broad awake. The Christian message is no opiate to send men to sleep. It is no comfortable assurance that everything will be all right. It's rather a blinding light which shows men themselves as they are and God as he is. Is that wonderful? Is that amazing? That's incredible. These things speak and exhort and rebuke with all authority. And the last phrase here, let no one disregard you. Literally that phrase, let no one disregard you, it means to think around something or someone. If I was to translate it in the Pastor Jeff translation, it would be this, don't be ignored. Titus, don't let anybody ignore you. Don't let them think around you. Don't let them bypass you. He's telling Titus that you have the authority to command people to obey the word of God. Remember, only when he was teaching and preaching the word of God. Make sense? But he had the authority to do that. And Paul is telling him very plainly, you have that authority. Pastors and elders today have the authority when they speak the word of God to demand obedience from the people, you mean, in the congregation. We're held to the same standard ourselves. And so, you mean, there are times when, you mean, church discipline may need to be practiced. Now, this is, again, stuff's not always easy to preach, folks. But again, we're here to share with you the whole counsel of the word of God. Take a look at some of the verses, you mean, here on the screen for you. Now, if your brother sins, this is in Matthew, if your brother sins, go and show him his what? Hey, you guys still awake? I'm worried about you. Still awake? Go show him his fault. What's it say? In what? In private first. Don't get that wrong. If he listens to you, hey, you've gained your brother. That's a rebuke. That's a correction. There are times when we need to do that for each other in the church. Accountability is important. But if he does not listen to you, take one or two more with you so that on the testimony of two or three witnesses, a matter may be established. And then verse 17, and if he refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if he refuses to listen to the church, he has to be to you as a what? As a Gentile or a tax collector. How did the Jews view the tax collectors and the Gentiles? You're out of here, bro. In the same context, verse 18, then we have a verse like this. Truly I say to you, again, he's speaking to the apostles here, whatever you bind on earth shall have been bound in heaven. And whatever you loose on earth shall have been loosed in heaven. Now, what's this all about? Well, binding and loosing are common phrases used by the rabbis in the first century to mean permit or forbid. And so the idea is that, you know, when, you mean, an elder, you mean, is calling, you mean, a person to return to obedience to Christ within the church who has become wayward. So you can't do these things. These things are forbidden. And he's not listening. And discipline must be brought to bear on that person, a confrontation, the possibility of being kicked out of the local assembly. That's very real. Do the pastors and the elders, you know, wield that authority in the church? They do. And so, you mean, you know, if they're not listening and they continue to go down that pathway, if this is something that you decide, you mean, here on earth, it's already been decided in heaven. Why? Because you're following the word of God. That heaven is already confirming that decision because it's already been laid out in Scripture. And so that's what Jesus is telling, you mean, these men, you mean, who were apostles at the time, and then that same thing is passed down, you mean, to the elders within the church, you know, today. Now, this is especially important because many times when you're talking about, you know, issues and things and, you know, problems creep up in a church, there's a lot of gray areas. Things that you can't, you know, go into the scriptures, you mean, and decide. Like, I mean, are we going to support this missionary or that missionary? We can't do both. Well, which one will we pick? Well, it's hard to open up a chapter and verse in the Bible and see which one we're supposed to pick. There's a lot of decisions that fall into that area, and in those areas, the elders also have authority. That's a protection, you mean, for them. Now, I understand that talking about these subjects is very uncomfortable, not just for you, but also for me. Because we live, I mean, in a country today, I mean, America, that was founded on the rebel spirit. You know, it was founded, I mean, on individual rights. And so there's this, you know, rugged individualism that has taken place, I mean, in our own nation that we still, you know, have as part of our national identity. You know, they're like, we're America. You know, we can do anything we want. We're a nation of cowboys and Marlboro smokers, you know, cigarette smoking, you know, that kind of thing. You know, remember those old commercials, the rugged, you know, American cowboy kind of person? That's the image of America, right? And today, I mean, in our own time, we see that an anti-authority attitude permeates all of American culture. I mean, you're talking to a guy who was raised on John Cougar Mellencamp. I fight authority, authority always will. I've been doing it since I was a young man and I come out grinning. No, I don't know. That was on the rejected worship song list for this morning. So, you know, we were going to do it, but we decided against it. But anyway. You know, that's the general attitude of people today. And especially the younger you are, the less respect you have for authority. Now, what's caused this? Again, it's ingrained in part of our culture, but the failure of parents to discipline children, a high divorce rate, the very first authority that I'm accountable to in my life is my mom and my dad. And when they hurt me, it causes me to question every authority in my life. It's stoked by crooked politicians and fallen pastors that add fuel to the anti-authority attitude that we have. It is so hard to find good, trustworthy leaders in any walk of life today that people have just simply given up. That's it. I don't trust anybody. And I understand that. And people have come by that honestly, you know, today. But against that is the commands of Scripture. That there is an authority structure in the church that comes from God and has been given to the church's leaders, its elders. And they wield that power from the Lord, but they don't wield it lightly. Our goal, you mean, as elders, is to wield it as the Lord Jesus did in his incarnation. Who, though he was the Son of God and could have demanded that all of the earth fall on their knees and worship him, but instead he put the towel around his waist and served the people that he held authority over. That's the spirit in which, as elders, I mean, we hope to minister and wield the authority that God has given to us. Because there's a lot of false authority out there. A lot of pastors promising a lot of feel-good stuff that the Word of God never teaches. Talk about that a lot around here, right? Hey, folks, you just trust God. You just believe in him. You mean he's going to take care of all your financial needs, all your health needs, all your grocery needs, all your pharmaceutical needs. He's going to give you everything you want and a pony. Look in your backyard. Amazing. Amazing. Is that what God's Word says? Hey, if you're right with God, everything's going to go smoothly with you. You're never going to have a problem. You're never going to have an issue. Everything's going to be great. Is that the message in the New Testament? Uh-uh. That's wielding false authority. Pastors who say whatever their congregation wants to hear so as never to offend anyone. Never talk about anything uncomfortable. Just all feel good, pump you up, you know, tickle your ears a little bit. We ain't doing that here. We ain't doing that here. Now, there's a time to encourage. And there's a time for rebuke. Again, we're teaching the whole counsel of the Word of God. Not just part of it, but all of it. That's my responsibility. And I don't preach on what I preach about based upon, you mean, how people are going to like it or not like it. That's not within my responsibility. My responsibility is to teach it faithfully. What the Scriptures say, all of it. Not my own opinions. Not false promises, but the truth. You know what else is a wielding of false authority? Controlling legalistic sin sniffers, cult-like, you know, leadership. You mean it dominates every area of your life? Think they can tell you what to do everywhere and everything and every way? Holding you to standards that are non-biblical, extra-biblical, that aren't taught in the scriptures? Using guilt and shame even as a weapon to bludgeon their congregation over and over and over again? Nope, that ain't it either. That is a misuse of authority. Now, there's a balance between those two things, and it's called the scriptures, and that's where we need to stay. And also not teaching false doctrines derived from extra-biblical sources. Many churches do that today. They claim to be, an authority. They're wielding God's authority, and they don't derive their authority from the scriptures. They derive it from the popes, or from the writings, of the church fathers or whatever. No, it's the scriptures that give anyone authority. Now, as we come to the end of this message, I want to call the worship team up because we need to get out of here. But I want to share just a personal story with you. When I started, in ministry, I came out of Philadelphia College of Bible when I was, in my early 20s. And, I was hired here, as a youth pastor. It's the first and only job I've ever had. And, when I came to the church here, I was hired by the elders. Many of those elders who are still here today in this church, some of which are still serving as elders. I am under their authority. The pastors are not above the authority in this church. We are accountable to the elders. And I serve at their pleasure. And the accountability that they have brought to my life has made all the difference for me. Because I know that every day I have to watch my life. Again, I'm far from perfect. Ask Steph. Well, don't ask Steph. You might not be able to handle what she tells you. But I understand and I recognize that every day I have to look at those elders. I have to serve beside these men. Some of these men are original to the time when I got here. Some of these men I've worked with and have been my friends and my companions. Many of the elders that are serving here have been served for more years than I can count, and that is unheard of in a church today. And I mean unheard of. And I have been honored to serve alongside of them. You men, I have the greatest respect for you, our elders, our deacons. Thank you for serving so faithfully and guiding this church, and this is coming from my heart. Elders have authority. I don't wield it lightly, and it is a tremendous responsibility. And many of you in here will never know all of the crap that they have to deal with continually. What they've sacrificed to lead this church faithfully over the last 35, 40, some of them more than that, years. A lifetime ministry. And it's been our honor and our blessing to serve you folks. And I pray every day that we serve you well. With honor and faithfulness and a passion for the Word of God and for Jesus Christ. And I'm not blowing smoke, as Kenny says. Here's what we need from you folks. Number one, you hold us accountable to teaching the Word of God. Demand it from us. And we stick on the Scriptures. Number two, remember that we're a constant target of the enemy. If the church can bring the leadership of the church down, he's going to succeed. And I am bound and determined by the grace of God that Satan has no quarter to do that here in this church. We need God's grace to serve well. We're not perfect men. But our desire is to see God glorified, the Word of God preached, the lost saved, and lives transformed, full stop, period, end of story. I hope that's why you're here. We're not playing. That's our goal. Would you please pray for us with these things? Pray for us. We need it.
I echo everything he just said. Being able to serve at the pleasure of the elder board is nothing less than a joy and a privilege. Satan, though, he knows that he wants to bring us down. His time is short, so he's angry. He does everything he can. But by the prayers of the people, God sustains us. So we thank you for that in advance. But what also keeps us moving forward is recognizing that we're not just doing this for our own glory, our own popularity, or gaining anything from it monetarily. We're doing this because we get to serve God. My daughter asked me years ago, she said, "Daddy, who's your boss?" I said, "Jesus. He's the best boss I've ever had." And so for our final song, I'd like to recognize that where our ultimately the authority goes to. He gives us great privileges here, but we are subject to him just as you are. And we have the same access that you do. You have the same access that we do to that Son who is above all. So please stand as we sing, "Crown Him with Many Crowns." Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns all music but its own. Awake my soul and sing of him who died for me, and hail him as thy matchless king. Father, we thank you that we serve a risen Savior who lives that death may die. May you keep all of those who are in authority and on the straight and narrow. Remove the lies and the temptations from the enemy, that we would follow after you only, not for our own pride or our own gain, but instead by our love for you and the love for the people of which you've given us. And may everybody here also hold us accountable as we all try to follow after you in full love, not on works, lest we would lose our first love, but instead by the grace that comes to us through your risen Son. May the Lord bless you and keep you and cause his face to shine upon you, be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In Jesus' name, amen. Go in peace.